Welcome to Meddy Simplified. Today we are going to discuss another topic from ENT named as Acoustic Neuroma. Okay, what is Acoustic Neuroma? Acoustic means something related to hearing. And neuroma means tumor in nerve fiber. So what acoustic neuroma means? Tumor in the nerve fiber related to hearing. So we all know the 12 pairs of cranial nerve. So in that, the 8th cranial nerve, that is the vestibular cochlear nerve, 8th cranial nerve is related to hearing. So let's take a structure of neuron. Suppose it is a neuron, a myelinated one. This is the nucleus. This is the nucleus. This is the dendrites. This is the axon. This is the axon terminals. This is a myelinated neuron. Myelinated neuron. So what we have in a myelinated neuron is, suppose this is the myelin sheath. So the myelin sheath is made up of schwann cells, and in between this is nodes of Ranvier. Suppose this is the 8th cranial nerve. Here we have nucleus, axon, myelin sheath, axon terminal. So this myelin sheath is made up of the Schwann cells. So acoustic neuroma is a neuroma which arises from the Schwann cell, of the 8th cranial nerve. So that is why this acoustic neuroma is also called as first 8th cranial nerve tumor, 8th nerve tumor. It is also called as it is originating from Schwann cells, it is called as schwanomma, and it is of 8th cranial nerve, so we call it as a vestibular schwanomma. Another name for Schwann cell is myelin, so it is also called as neurilimoma. These are the name of acoustic neuroma. It is benign. It is benign encapsulated. Extremely slow growing tumor of myelin forming cells, that is the Schwann cell of 8th cranial nerve. So what is acoustic neuroma? Acoustic neuroma is benign, encapsulated, extremely slow growing tumor of myelin forming cells of 8th cranial nerve. It is also called as 8th nerve tumor. It is also called as vestibular schwannoma. It is also called as neurolimoma. What else we should know about acoustic neuroma is, it is most common intracranial schwannoma. It is most common intracranial schwannoma. Also, it is most common benign tumor. It is most common benign tumor seen in cerebellopontine angle. What is cerebellopontine angle? I'll draw a diagram for the better understanding. Suppose Suppose this is the temporal bones, precursor part of temporal bone. This is pons. Here we have cerebellum. So this angle is called as cerebellopontine angle. What else we have over here in this, near this angle? This is the posterior cranial fossa. Here we have middle cranial fossa. We have three vessels over here. So this one is the jugular foramen, where we see three nerves, cranial nerves passing, which are 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerve, and through this jugular foramen. Then we have internal acoustic meatus, from where we see 8th and 7th cranial nerve passing. Also here we have in this angle, we have the largest cranial nerve, that is the, not largest, the cranial nerve number 5th, which is present over here. These are the three branches of 5th cranial nerve. So this angle between the pons and cerebellum is called as cerebellopontine angle. At this site, the most common benign tumor seen is acoustic neuroma. This is the 8th cranial nerve, this is the 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerve, and this is the 5th cranial nerve. So what is acoustic neuroma? It is a benign encapsulated extremely slow growing tumor of myelin forming cells of 8th cranial nerve. It is also called as 8th nerve tumor, vestibular schwannomma, neuroliboma. It is most common intracranial schwannomma. It is most common benign tumor seen in the cerebellopontine angle. Okay, now we will discuss how does the tumor grows. Okay, so what we will discuss about this? The growth of tumor. First, we will discuss what will happen if the tumor will grow anterior, superiorly. What will happen if the tumor grows inferiorly? And if it expands very large. So let's come to this small diagram once again of the cerebellopontine angle. Suppose we have a tumor at the 8th cranial nerve, intracranially. So this is the cerebellopontine angle. It will start growing bigger and bigger. If the tumor will start growing anterior superiorly, so it will affect the 5th cranial nerve. If it is growing inferiorly, it will affect the 8th, 9th and 7th cranial nerve, and also the 7th cranial nerve. It will affect 7th, 9th and 10th, 11th cranial nerve. If it further expands to a greater size, it will affect the brain stem. So we'll discuss how the tumor grows. If the tumor is at the cerebellopontine angle, it will continue its growth. At cerebellopontine angle, it will continue its growth. And if it is expanding further, and it is expanding anterior superiorly, then what will it affect? It will affect the 5th cranial nerve. 5th cranial nerve. 5th cranial nerve is the first cranial nerve affected. It is the first cranial nerve affected due to acoustic neuroma after 8th cranial nerve. Then if the tumor grows inferiorly, as we discussed, then it will affect 7th, 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerve. Then if the tumor expands further, it may displace the brain stem, it may displace the brain stem and will increase the intracranial pressure. Once again, let's discuss how the tumor grows. If it is growing, if the tumor will be found mostly at the cerebellum pontine, it will grow and expand from there. If it is growing anterior posteriorly, it will affect the fifth cranial nerve. Okay, the fifth cranial nerve is the first cranial nerve affected due to acoustic neuroma. Then if it is growing inferiorly, it will affect 7th, 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerve. If it expands further, it may displace the brainstem and increase the intracranial pressure. Okay, so now let's take some question related to acoustic neuroma. First question, most common site of acoustic neuroma. Acoustic neuroma is, the first option is fossa of Rosenmuller, option B, let's take retropharyngeal space. C, cerebellar pontine angle, and option D, none. The question is, most common site of acoustic neuroma is, first option A is fossa of Rosenmuller, option B, retropharyngeal space, option C, cerebellar pontine angle, option D, none. So the answer here we know is cerebellar pontine angle. So let's take the question number 2. Most common cerebellopontine angle tumor is, okay, the options are A, acoustic neuroma, B, meningioma, option C, cholesteatoma, or option D, all of the above. Question is, most common cerebellopontine angle tumor is A, acoustic neuroma, B, meningioma, C, cholesteatoma, or D, all of the above. So the answer is acoustic neuroma. So we'll take the same options, but let's change the question. Question number 3. Which of the following lesion, which of the lesions is seen at cerebellopontine angle, with same options. Option number A, acoustic neuroma, option number B, meningioma, option number C, cholesteatoma, and option number D, all of the above. So here the answer will be all of the above. This, all the three tumors are seen in at the cerebellopontine angle. So let's write something about cerebellopontine angle. The lesions at cerebellopontine angle are, most commonly seen is acoustic neuroma, which contributes almost 80% of the time. Second is meningioma, 10% of the tumor seen at cerebellopontine angle are meningioma usually. Third is congenital cholesteatoma, 5% of the cases are due to cholesteatoma, and last is others, any other tumor which contributes 5%. So if the question comes, which of the lesion is seen at cerebellopontine angle, usually people tend to mark acoustic neuroma, but these are the remaining two which we should remember, that meningioma and congenital cholesteatoma is also seen at cerebellopontine angle. So if we get a question, which of the following is seen at cerebellopontine angle, acoustic neuroma, meningioma, cholesteatoma, and all of the above, we should mark the answer as all of the above. And if the question is most common cerebellopontine angle tumor, then the answer will be acoustic neuroma, as it contributes 80 to 90% of the tumor seen at cerebellopontine angle. Ok, Okay, now let's discuss about the clinical features of acoustic neuroma. It is usually seen in the people of age 40 to 60 years of age. It is seen equally in males and females. It is usually present unilaterally, but if it is associated with neurofibromatosis type 2, which is seen in the disease called as von Rick-Langhausen's disease. Then this disease is seen, this acoustic neuroma is seen bilaterally. What is von Rick-Langhausen's disease? It is a genetic disorder characterized by growth of tumor on nerve fibers. So what are the clinical features of acoustic neuroma? It is seen in the people of age group 40 to 60 years of age. It is equally seen in males and females. It is present unilaterally in 90% of cases, but in 10% of cases it is present bilaterally only. It is due to the association with the neurofibromatosis type 2. Like in the disease von Rick-Langhausen's disease, what it is? It is a genetic disorder characterized by growth of tumor on the nerve fibers. Okay, now we will discuss the clinical symptoms of acoustic neuroma. The earliest symptom which is visible is, cochlear vestibular symptoms. Which are those? In this case, they are tinnitus and deafness. We see progressive unilateral sensorineural hearing loss. The other symptom depends on which of the cranial nerves have been involved. If suppose the seventh cranial nerve has been affected, so what we'll see is Hitzelberger's sign. We will see Schwann's test or sign, we can call it. We will see electrophysiometry. What is Hitzelberger's sign? It is loss of sensation in posterior aspects of concha. Schwann's test is reduced lacrimation. In electrogastrometry, we will see loss of taste at anterior 2/3 of tongue. Suppose we'll see the involvement of fifth cranial nerve. So what we will see? We'll see reduced corneal reflex, and paresthesia of face. Suppose we'll see the involvement of 9th and 10th cranial nerve. So what will we see? We'll see paralysis in palate, in larynx, and in pharynx. So what are the clinical symptoms of acoustic neuroma? The earliest symptom seen is cochlear-vestibular symptom, which includes tinnitus and deafness. In this case, we'll see progressive unilateral sensorineural hearing loss. If seventh cranial nerve is involved, we'll see Hitzelberger's sign, that is loss of sensation in the posterior aspects of cornea. In Sirmer's sign, we'll see reduced lacrimation. Electrogastrometry, we'll see the loss of taste at the anterior two-third of tongue. If fifth cranial nerve is involved, we'll see reduced corneal reflexes and we'll see paresthesia of face. If 9th and 10th cranial nerve are involved, we'll see paralysis in the palate, larynx and pharynx. Also, we can call it as laryngeal or pharyngeal paralysis. So, these are the clinical symptoms of acoustic neuroma. Okay, now once again, let's take some questions related to acoustic neuroma. The first question is, Hitzelberger's sign is seen in, the options are mastoiditis, B, Bell's palsy, C, vestibular schwanomma, or D, none. Hitzelberger's sign is seen in. What is Hitzelberger's sign? It is numbness or loss of sensation in the posterior aspect of cornea. So where do we see this sign positive? We see it in vestibular schwanomma, that is acoustic neuroma. It is usually seen if we have the involvement of 7th cranial nerve. So Hitzelberger's sign is seen in vestibular schwanomma. So the next question is, earliest cranial nerve involved in acoustic neuroma is? So let's take the option as A, 5th cranial nerve, B, 9th cranial nerve, C, 10th cranial nerve, or D, 11th cranial nerve. So which is the earliest cranial nerve involved in acoustic neuroma? It is the 5th cranial nerve. So if we will get the question, which is the earliest cranial nerve involved in acoustic neuroma, in vestibular schwanomma, or in the 8th cranial nerve tumor? The answer will be 5th cranial nerve. Next question. Earliest sign seen in acoustic neuroma is? Earliest sign seen in acoustic neuroma is option A, pharyngeal paralysis, option B, reduced lacrimation, option C, reduced corneal reflex, and option D, loss of taste. So earliest sign seen in acoustic neuroma. First we'll check whether all of this sign is seen in acoustic neuroma or not. If it is not seen, then we'll exclude that option. So the first option is pharyngeal paralysis. Yes, it is seen if the 9th and 10th cranial nerve is involved. Second option, reduced lacrimation. Yes, it is seen if the 7th cranial nerve is involved. Loss of taste. Yes, it is seen if 7th cranial nerve is involved. And reduced corneal reflex. Yes, it is seen if the 5th cranial nerve is involved. So, all of the signs is seen in acoustic neuroma. So, what is the question? Which is the earliest sign seen in acoustic neuroma? So, we need to know which of the cranial nerve is earliest involved if we have acoustic neuroma. So, we had a question. Earliest cranial nerve involved is in acoustic neuroma is? So the answer was fifth cranial nerve. So which of the symptom or sign is seen if fifth cranial nerve is involved will be the correct answer. So pharyngeal paralysis is seen if seventh cranial nerve is involved, if ninth or tenth cranial nerve is involved. So it is not the answer. Reduced lacrimation, it is seen if seventh cranial nerve is involved. So this is not answer. Loss of taste is also seen if seventh cranial nerve is involved. So it is not the answer. The first, the earliest cranial nerve involved is fifth, and reduced cranial reflex is seen if fifth cranial nerve is involved. So the right answer is reduced cranial reflex. One more question. We have not discussed it yet. So let's take this question. The investigation of choice for acoustic neuroma is, we have options. Option A, CT scan. Option B is HRCT, or we have 10 seconds, so we'll take PET scan. Option C, MRI with gadolinium scan. Or option D, biopsy. We have not discussed the topic, like the investigation part yet. So I'll just mark the correct answer. Investigation of choice for acoustic neuroma is, the answer is MRI with gadolinium scan. So what is the investigation of choice for acoustic neuroma? It is MRI with gadolinium contrast. Sorry, MRI with gadolinium contrast. So these are the sub questions. Now we'll discuss about the treatment of acoustic neuroma. So the treatment. In case of acoustic neuroma, surgery is the treatment of choice for acoustic neuroma. What we do, we just remove the tumor surgically. Removal of tumor using surgery. We use various approaches for the removal of tumor. They are, first, middle cranial fossa approach, we have rectosigmoidal approach, we have labyrinthine approach, and the last, retro labyrinthine approach. Out of this four approach, the most commonly used is translabyrinthine approach. We also go for radiotherapy, which includes gamma knife surgery. Here we use cobalt 60, which is a radioisotope of cobalt, as the source of radiation. There are some advantages of using this gamma knife surgery. That is, the seventh cranial nerve will be preserved. The hearing will be preserved, and we'll see no case of death, that is, no morbidity will be seen. An advanced technique known as cyber knife is also being used nowadays. What is cyberknife? It is a robotic surgery. It is a robotic surgery which is done using computer controlled robots. So what is the treatment of acoustic neuroma? Surgery is the treatment of choice for acoustic neuroma. We have four approaches. That is the middle cranial fossa approach, retrosigmoidal approach, retrolabyrinthine approach, translabyrinthine approach. Out of these four approach, we usually go for translabyrinthine approach, which is most commonly used approach. We also go for radiotherapies like gamma knife surgery. Here we use copal 60 as a source of radiation. The advantage of this gamma knife surgery is that the seventh cranial nerve is preserved. Along with it, the hearing of the patient is preserved and we'll see no morbidity. An advanced technique called a cyber knife surgery is done using robots. It is a robotic surgery and is done using computer controlled robots. So let's have a short review about the acoustic neuroma. What is acoustic neuroma? It is the tumor in the nerve fiber which is growing slowly. So it is a benign, encapsulated, slow growing tumor of the myelin forming cells of 8th cranial nerve. It is usually seen at 90% of the cases. The most common site of this acoustic neuroma is cerebellopontine angle, and it is most common intracranial schwannomma. The other cranial nerve, if the tumor is growing, the other cranial nerve which are involved are 5th. If it is growing anterior superiorly, if it is growing inferiorly, it will affect the 9th, 10th and 11th and sometimes 7th cranial nerve. If it is growing very largely, if it is expanding very largely, it may displace the brainstem. And what is the investigation of choice? Clinical symptoms. It depends on which cranial nerve is involved. So we have discussed it already. Then the investigation of choice is MRI using gadolinium contrast. The treatment of choice is surgery, which is done using four approaches, out of which the translabyrinthine approach is the most commonly used approach. We use radiotherapy like gamma knife surgery using cobalt 60 as a source of radiation. Also we use cyberknife, which is the modern technique done using robots. Thank you. That was all about acoustic neuroma. Please like, share and subscribe my channel Meddy Simplified. Thank you.